Good afternoon, ABA Division for Public Education Social Media audience. As always, I am thrilled to be joined by Professor Stephen D. Schwinn of the University of Illinois of Chicago School of Law. Professor Schwinn, thank you for being here during what is a very busy couple of days for the Supreme Court.
Indeed, it's good to be back with you, Kathy.
You know, we had said, lamented a bit between ourselves a few weeks ago about how slow the court was releasing some of these opinions. And in this last couple of days, tie up those running shoes and hit the ground because we've got a bunch of cases to unpack.
We've got a flood. Yeah. So a number came down today and a couple of big ones, right?
Yeah. So I think for this conversation, we're really going to focus on cases from this week that deal with students, whether they be high school students or college athletes. So Professor Schwinn, can you start us off by digging into the Ma Hanoi versus BL case, otherwise known as the cheerleader cursing First Amendment case?
Exactly, the cursing cheerleader case. So this was a cheerleader at a public high school who was on the junior varsity team, but was gunning for the varsity team. Didn't get on the varsity team. So she went to an off-campus convenience store and posted on Snapchat a vulgar criticism of the cheerleading team, not mentioning the school, not mentioning any individual, but word got back to school authorities and she was punished by being suspended from even the JV team for the next year. So she brought a First Amendment free speech challenge against the school and school authorities, arguing that the punishment violated her free speech rights to convey her feelings about the varsity cheerleading team.
And so what did the court say in its ruling? I think this has been a really anticipated and hotly watched ruling. It's the first time in 50 years we've gotten sort of a direct ruling on some free speech rights as they apply to students. What was the outcome?
It's a big case. And the reason why is because the question for the court was, to what extent can school authorities regulate off-campus speech that has something to do with school, but only in a kind of tangential way? And so what the court said is free speech applies off campus. It may apply in a somewhat different way than it does on campus, but it nevertheless applies and protects student speech off campus, and that this speech was indeed protected speech, and that this cheerleader couldn't have been punished. In her punishment did violate First Amendment free speech rights.
So Steve, we have this as an 8-1 ruling with Justice Thomas in the dissent. Are you surprised that it was so close to being a unanimous ruling, even though this is seen as kind of being a significant ruling? And I feel like normally significant rulings don't tend to be unanimous or 8-1. Is this a big deal?
It's hard to say, Kathy. I mean, you know, in hindsight, it's always easier, comfortable to say, no, we perfectly saw this coming. I think the one thing that we could see coming was Justice Thomas's dissent. He takes the position that school authorities have long had power over students to regulate their speech on or off campus if it relates to school activities, whatever. And so Justice Thomas dissented and said that this was not protected by First Amendment free speech because school authorities have been doing this for a long, long time. Now, as to the other eight, I could have seen maybe a couple of other justices going in a dissent for a different reason. Turns out they didn't. I mean, this was a really strong free speech opinion for off-campus student speech.
Yeah, I think there was the chance, the court upheld what the Third Circuit had done, but I think it certainly narrowed what the Third Circuit had done and allows both for a recognition of free speech rights off campus, but didn't go as far as the Third Circuit did, which was to say that there should be no school regulation of speech off campus. So from my perspective with what the court did here, I think it's pretty substantial in what they're saying about student rights and student free speech rights, but they're giving administration and school districts some leeway and some space to be able to regulate in this area. And I think, you know, the court pretty clearly in balancing this is creating yet another test that we may see get defined and refined and applied in the next 10 to 15 years and really have a better understanding of what BL means in its application. Because I think the court was pretty clear in the test that it was creating or announcing, and we'll see how that actually gets applied, particularly with social media and the push and a lot of this speech happening off campus, or even if it's, if the typing on the phone is happening off campus, it's happening outside of the school's sort of community, and what that means going forward.
I think that's a really good point. And, you know, what I think is kind of interesting to think about that is not only the social media aspect of this, but the off-campusness of the speech. Mm-hmm. And to what degree can school authorities regulate off-campus speech? The court did give some good guidance. And I think what I found particularly interesting is that it seemed to kind of allow for the possibility of school regulation for off-campus speech based in large part on amicus filings in the case that suggested that there are a lot of ways that off-campus speech can affect the goings-on at school, the mission of education. And so to the extent that off-campus speech is interfering with the school's mission, the schools certainly can regulate it under this opinion. And I think that makes it a kind of fun case to play with in the classroom, right? If we're using this in, say, a high school civics class or a high school government class or constitutional law class, we can think of all kinds of examples where off-campus speech may or may not have an effect on the mission of the school, and then work around this case, work around Tinker, work mm-hmm. around the Bong Hits for Jesus case, right? Remember that one? And really, I think have some real good time with some facts.
Yeah, I think you're spot on. I love to do some First Amendment cases with students regarding dress codes and having them come up with their own dress codes and then trying to apply them and saying, okay, well, what about this shirt? Does this shirt apply? And same goes for the Minnesota case dealing with dress codes at the polls. And I think this is another one where you could ask the students to be school administrators and following the direction of what the court laid out today, the three different factors and its considerations, what does your policy look like? And then challenge them and say, what if a student does this? Does this violate it? And I think there's some really great simulations and hands-on activities here that for classroom application here.
Yeah, for sure.
So Steve, place this in a little bit of the larger Roberts Court First Amendment jurisprudence. Does this fall in line with where we've seen the chief in this court? Although I recognize this is a newer court than what we used to have. Is this within their First Amendment doctrine? What does it tell us about potential other First Amendment challenges?
So this falls squarely in the trend line of the Roberts Court for First Amendment and free speech jurisprudence. And what I mean by that is this is a court that has been vigorously protective of free speech rights in all different contexts. And this opinion too is vigorously protective of free speech rights, even though it recognizes that the government may regulate speech off campus. It also recognizes that students have robust free speech rights, even when they're off campus, on campus, any time.
Yeah, absolutely. I thought Justice Breyer, in writing the decision for the majority, really talks. I appreciated his reflection on if we are saying schools can regulate student speech on campus, and then we're also giving schools carte blanche to regulate it out of campus, that's 24 hours of the day. And where do students have any ability to exercise free speech rights? I thought it's something that definitely stuck with me in considering this and sort of providing that balance between making sure that the schools have the authority that they need to ensure that the school community and environment is a safe place for learning, but also, you know, making sure students have the ability to exercise these important rights.
Absolutely. And I love that 24/7. And the idea of in loco parentis also came up in the opinion. And what are schools' roles with regard to students, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, they do serve this in loco parentis rule, but if they can regulate students 24/7, then students are never not students for First Amendment purposes. And that doesn't make any sense. And then I love the phrase, and this is so Justice Breyer, nurseries of democracy.
Right? I knew that was the one you were going to say when you said it was so Justice Breyer.
Yeah. And so you've got this really sort of interesting and complex relationship between schools and students. You've got the in loco parentis relationship. You've got the relationship, even when students aren't in school to some degree. And then you've got this idea of nurseries of democracy in this opinion as well. It's just, it's beautiful.
I thought particularly for champions of civic education and sort of folks who are doing this work nationally and really put, or on the ground in local communities, really pushing for civic education and civics within schools. There's a lot to dig into that Breyer opinion. And he really pulls at the heartstrings of why some of this education and allowing students the freedom to experience this and to learn how to do this within schools is really critical and really important.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. So Steve, changing gears a smidge, jumping ahead in a student's career, let's talk a little bit about college athletes and what the Supreme Court had to say about their rights or what schools owe them. So earlier this week, we had NCAA versus Alston, which is another, I think, was well-watched and hoped-for case dealing with the NCAA's restrictions on student athlete compensation. And this was a case that student athletes had challenged some of the restrictions and some of the NCAA's enforcement of these restrictions as Section 1 Sherman Act violations, which tends to have folks glaze over when we start to talk about Sherman Act antitrust violations. But can you tell us and our audience what this case dug into and what the court held here?
Sure. So in the NCAA, you have, I guess what we'll call in air quotes, maybe amateur athletes, right? And amateur athletes who often get scholarships to go to school that cover things like tuition and room and board and books, and also get other kinds of benefits from the schools that they attend because they're athletes. And bring in revenue to the school. The problem is that NCAA rules cap the amount of benefits that these athletes can receive. And what that means is that while these athletes are bringing in millions of dollars, billions of dollars in aggregate of revenue to Division I schools, particularly in football and basketball programs, they're not getting compensated for the benefits that they're bringing to the schools. And as a result, they, the argument that they make is a Sherman Act argument, saying that the NCAA is restraining free trade in their compensation for the benefit that they're providing to the schools. And it, you know, it makes sense if you think about these athletes as providing all of these financial benefits to the schools and yet not getting nearly the kind of compensation that a completely open market might demand for the benefit that they're bringing to their schools.
So we had this as a unanimous decision, and the court agreed with the students. They said that, you know, these restrictions, particularly, and I wanna make clear to our audience, it's with regards to the education related benefits. So there's been, these issues have been challenged for decades at this point. And this particular case was dealing with the education related benefits. So computers, textbooks, time spent in tutoring sessions, that sort of thing. That the restrictions as related to those were violations of the Sherman Antitrust Act. Steve, was there anything interesting out of either the majority opinion or the Justice Kavanaugh had a concurrence? Anything coming out of those opinions that you were struck by?
Yeah, well, I think you hit the nail on the head, Kathy, that this is it's a narrow opinion in that it deals with what the court calls only education-related benefits. And that turns out to be a kind of narrow subset of what student athletes might receive and what the NCAA might cap. And so while the majority dealt with this narrow set of benefits, Justice Kavanaugh wrote in concurrence that he thinks that all the benefits that student athletes receive, whether they're educational-related or not, could be caps on those benefits could violate the same Sherman antitrust provision. And what he is essentially doing is inviting the next generation of review in these cases. So as you've said, we've been having these debates for decades now. The Supreme Court has finally ruled on this, and Justice Kavanaugh goes yet a step further, and it really invites the next generation of review. Now, at the same time, Congress is looking at these issues. Mm-hmm. And Congress has the authority under its Commerce Clause power to allow the NCAA to to cap benefits in, to some degree or not. And because this is a statutory case, the ruling really does kick the can back to Congress.
Yeah, absolutely. I think in his majority opinion, Justice Gorsuch directly calls on Congress or directly calls on the NCAA to go to Congress to lobby for the restrictions or the ability to do the restrictions that I would want. I think it's also important to look at the other side of the coin when it comes to the legislative efforts, though, which is in less than a couple of weeks, many states have some legislation going into policy that directly impact what's happening at the state level in this area and allowing for these for compensation. And in some cases, maybe even going so far as to allow for direct payment. And I think we're going to see some litigation probably coming out of that with the NCAA. And I think there's going to be dramatic changes there could be dramatic changes in college sports and the competitive nature of what one state is able to do versus another state. That may have some more real world implication than this case necessarily does, because as you said, it is really a narrow ruling on a narrow set of benefits here.
It is. And you think about the policy around this, what the court is largely talking about and what the NCAA and the student athletes are largely concerned about are those big revenue sports, largely Division I football and basketball. But if you think about other sports, this could affect other student athletes as well, who receive various forms of benefits from the schools that they attend, in everything from, the crew team for rowing to gymnastics to whatever. And so when Congress is considering this, and really when the court's considering it, it ought to be considering all athletes who are receiving these benefits from the schools.
Yeah, absolutely. And I just think it's such, you mentioned that it's the narrowness of the education benefits and that these are athletes. I also think it's a narrowness for the Sherman Act itself, that this does not have wide application to antitrust law beyond the NCAA. And I think Justice Kavanaugh talked about it a little bit, that, this amateur idea and college sports are different and they're in the fabric of American lives. And so this is not something that's going to impact challenges, antitrust challenges beyond this very sort of narrow industry, for lack of a better term.
Yeah, I think that's right. And it is, the NCAA and Division I sports, well, all college sports are really in kind of unique situation in this regard. One thing that I found interesting in the opinion, Justice Gorsuch kind of traces the history of college sports in the beginning of his opinion and talks about how this idea of amateurism has changed over time, right? And so we have an idea of what an amateur athlete is today, might have been very different 50 or 100 years ago. And I think that's important to keep in mind as well. This is an evolving concept of amateur athletics, and this is just yet another step in the evolution of our understanding of that idea.
Well, Steve, I know we have a busy week ahead of us, so I hope you will join us again to dig into some more of the cases that have come out or will be coming out into our audience. I promise to harass Professor Schwinn as much as possible and get him here for your viewing pleasure in the coming days. Thank you, Steve, as always.
Thanks, Kathy. Good to be with you.